God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. From the Gospel of Luke chapter 15 we read, "And the younger of them said unto his father, Father, give me the portions of goods that falleth to me, and he divided unto him his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all that together, took his journey to a far country, and wasted his substance with riotous living. We have come a long way from the days of the Garden of Eden. We have come from a long way of God blessing us with health, with life, with eyes, with the ability to eat, with the ability to smell, with the riches that we have in America today, with all the blessings that God has blessed us when we are outside of his fellowship. We are not with God because of sin. For all have sinned and come to short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one." Realize that one day our father Adam and our mother Eve was in the garden with the presence, without sin, without troubles, without problems. And one day, they've done something that God told them not to do. God commanded them not to eat the fruit. And yet, one day, they took a bite of that fruit, whatever the fruit was, and they entered into the condemnation of being sinners because they had rebelled against the Word of God. And they were driven out of the garden by God. Genesis chapter 3, they were driven away. You are driven away from God today. You are not in the presence of God. You cannot be in the presence of God except you have the way, the truth, and the life. "For no man cometh unto the Father but by me." Those words were spoken by the Lord Jesus Christ. Without the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, without the gospel that Jesus Christ died for your sins, was buried, and arose again the third day according to the scriptures, you are outside of God. Religion cannot save you. Religion cannot bring that fellowship back to you. There's only one mediator between God and man, that is the man Christ Jesus. We are here to tell you today that you are outside the Father without the Lord Jesus Christ. And yet, the Father has given you all kinds of blessings. And yet, what God has given to us, what God has blessed us with, you're not even thankful. You don't even praise the God. You praise the employer. You praise the bank. You praise the government. You praise everything but the God has given to you. God has given us life. And from life, God has given us ample opportunity after opportunity, no matter what color, what race, whatever creed we are. All men are created evil, and equal, and the fact is that the wages of sin is death. All men are going to die. And all men, the Bible says, prepare to meet thy God. As a man, as a woman, as a creed, or whatever you are, whatever age you are, you're going to die one day, and you're going to face God. Whether you have great riches or you live in the poorest community, you are a sinner, you're going to die, and you're going to face God. And there's only one way to please God, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. Now this young man, God has given him all kinds of blessings, and it records that he lived in righteous living. What is righteous living? Righteous living is found in America. When we spend one day thinking footballs being thrown back and forth, and we spend the entire night for a time called Black Friday for something that's stupid that we're going to have to fight for next year to get number 6 of the model. When you battle it out in a grocery store, you battle it out in a department store for one stupid thing, and you spend all your money for that stupid thing, that's righteous living. Righteous living is when you buy something to shoot it in your arm, and you're going to need more, and you're going to need more money to get it, and you take it from others to get that little shot in your arm. That's righteous living. Righteous living is when you buy everybody around at the bar, you buy everybody that booze, you buy whoever, whatever, however. That's righteous living. And with righteous living, you don't thank God. You don't even think about God. You don't even put God in your equation in your life. And yet, the Bible records to us that God the Father has divided His riches and given us amongst us. And when He had spent all, there arose a mighty famine that land. And He began to want. Listen, America cannot keep on going the way she's going and continue to receive the blessings of God that He has blessed her from the time that she has started as a biblical nation. This country has started on the foundation of God, and we have taken His word, we have taken Him out of the schools, we have taken Him out of the courtroom, we have taken Him out of the teachings of our children, we have taken Him out of the family, we have taken Him out of church, and you think that God's going to continue to bless when we are here at a farmer's market, when this fruit and vegetables that I see that are being purchased are brought to you by God. The weather is given for you to have these crops, and yet you don't thank God. I don't think that this farmer's market starts off on Saturday morning and say, let's all pray to God and thank God for this bounty, and so let's pray for the people come that we will not shortchange them. We'll give them all for their value, all for their dollar. We just want to praise to God and pray for that preacher to come and tell our people here about Jesus Christ. I doubt you do that. And you expect to continue to have God bless America? That'd be a lie. That'd be a phony. There's coming days of a famine. And if the famine is not of food,
pick another island and talk.
If the famine is not of vegetables, if the famine is not of fruit, the Bible says one day that there'll be a famine of the Word of God. You will get what you want. You will have one time there will be no Bible in the land. The Bible will be gone, the Bible says. And yet salvation will be far and wide. There's a famine coming in the land, and it's not a good time to have a famine. It's a famine time where you ought to know God. You ought to be with God. You ought to be about God in the famine time.
You eat, sleep, and drink God.
Water.
And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in land. He began to be the one. He went and joined himself to the citizens of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. Here we are. We are citizens of the United States of America. We are Americans, E-I-O. Hooray! We are citizens of a once great nation under God. The motto of America is God bless America. Now, I got to ask a question. I've got a question for our politicians in Washington, D.C. Which God? When I open up the yellow pages in the phone book and see churches, I see all kinds of gods. I see people who don't even believe in gods in America. But we have joined ourselves to the citizenship of a country, according to Luke 15, and we are feeding swine. In the Bible, swines are unclean, and thank God we are under mercy, because I enjoy a good pork chop.
I don't even believe but
the swine are very unclean to the Israelite people, and as the story relates in Luke 15, this young man has to have nothing to do with him. Your life, your work is unclean in the sight of God.
Why?
Glad you asked. Because you're not giving God the credit. You're not giving God the tithes. You're not offering to God. You're not praising God. You're not starting your work day at the desk, wherever you work, on the factory line, or at the grocery store, wherever you work. You are not starting your day on your knees with your boss, with your employees, with your co-workers, in prayers that God bless his name.
Proving to prove that asparagus that you claim God is providing.
And in your heart you said there's no God and thou art a fool.
I didn't say that, my friend. I did not say that.
Well, we were once a nation that was blessed by God by prayer and giving God thanks. Even we have one day to proclaim Thanksgiving. It ought to be 365 days. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us be glad and let us rejoice in it. For all the things that every day that we rejoice in, that's not God. Oh, it's terrible Monday. Oh, man, it's Monday. Yucky, it's Monday. It is a day that the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. You better thank God that you have a job. You realize that there are 400 people next year that I read in the paper who will be without jobs next year. This corporation I just read, they're going to lay off 800 people. You better thank God. You better thank the Holy God. You better thank Jesus Christ for a job Monday morning and for that.
Thank them for letting you off. No, sir. Thank them for providing it if they ever did.
And he would have fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. Now, that's not America today. America, you drive up to a window and you pick up your meal and you drive off. You just swipe that plastic and restaurants are a harsh, vast reality in America. And when was the last time you went into a restaurant and saw a family bow their head, holding hands, in a public restaurant and say, Lord God, thank you for this meal?
About a week ago, actually.
Well, there's one testimony.
That's frequent enough. You see it all the time, my friend.
This guy has no sense of reality. This guy is a fool.
Walk because I care about my fellow man. And I see what they do. They don't all the time do it, but people who believe in you...
Well, I said all the time. You're supposed to worship God all the time. But what I'm telling you right now is in America, that we are starving. We are famished. This guy doesn't even know what I'm going to say. He's a fool. We are starving because we are lacking God and the Word of God. And Jesus told Satan in the Gospels, the Word of the Lord Jesus Christ spoke, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. That is where we are famished. That is why you got killings in your schools. That's why you got people running around rampant with a gun. They're carrying a gun rather than a Bible. Sir, if you want to preach your message, there's other islands. I've got to ask you to leave. There's other islands you can preach.
This
not behind me.
Property.
Or then go preach on another island. Private
this
property.
Public property.
Well, go ahead.
Okay.
You think I'm interrupting your friend over there doing his business?
No.
You wouldn't appreciate that, would you?
Well, actually...
Would you appreciate if I went over to stop his business?
Well,
you're stopping my message.
May I ask you something?
No, I'm not asking your questions because you're just a fool. You just want to stop this message.
No.
When you're really serious, you come see me. I've already given you my information.
May I be serious?
No.
Okay.
No, you're not being serious. You're
a
never serious. I've got you recording all these messages as a fool, okay? The people who are going to watch this video are going to see you. I see that, hey, that fool's back.
May,
all right, stop interrupting me.
May I please ask you something?
No, I'm tired of your questions.
Interest.
When you want to know about the Lord Jesus Christ and His salvation, I'll tell you. No, you don't.
I've read the books.
So,
I've seen them. I've read them. Yes,
I'm not going to say anything more to you anymore. Absolutely not, unless you're truly serious and you're not serious. You're just trying to disrupt us.
No, I'm serious right now.
Oh, you may be serious. You know what? With all your games, I don't believe you. Okay?
Okay.
I'm going to go on.
Obviously the same for an average jovial.
Friends, We are in an absence of God. This son is in the absence of God. He does not have the Father, but he is getting the fatherly blessings. God is blessing him. This guy over here is trying to get solar power, but he doesn't forget that the solar power, the light in Genesis chapter 1 came from the Father. He said, let there be light. Let there be a sun. Let there be a moon. Let there be four stars. And you know what they were for? It wasn't to heat your house. It wasn't to give you television power. It was for time. It was for seasons. It's for events in your life to know how to plant vegetables.
Other than us, we are not the only people on the planet with sun.
See, we don't even give God the credit. We don't even realize what God has done for us. And we go about our life like there is no God. And yet the Bible says, prepare to meet thy God. You've got to come to God knowing one thing, that you are a sinner. You got to come to God and famish. You got to come to God feeding the swine and wanting the swine food. I don't know if you've ever seen what pigs eat, but pigs will eat what you do not eat. And pigs will eat little piggies. As they've done in the times when Jerusalem was sacked by Babylonians. And yet, when you read the story through Ezekiel and Jeremiah, even then those people did not get right. But if there's one son out there, if there's one person here who has the riches of God, and we all got the riches of God, thank God for the five senses. That is a rich of God. Not everybody has their eyesight. Not everybody can hear the gospel. They are lacking. And yet, if you are in this place right now and you are feeding amongst the hogs, that's the only meal you can get from an unclean life. Let me invite you. Let me show you by the word of God, the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me show you how to come out of that pig, how to come out of that mire, how to get strengthened in the Lord, because we're going to find that in Luke 15. This guy does not stay in the hog mire. This guy does not stay in his sin. This guy gets right. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough to spare and perish, and I perish with hunger? He says, what about the servants of my father? I am a servant of the Father. I'm not a Jehovah Witness. I'm a Jehovah servant. And I have bread to the full, because the Lord Jesus Christ said, I am the bread of life. Jesus said, I am the water of life. Yeah, a man may starve to death in Christ, but spiritually and physically, upon death, he'll be present with the Lord with great riches. There is suffering. There are problems right now on this earth, but there's one thing that's going to happen. You're going to die, and you're going to face God. Face God with the blood and the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you may be saved. Because nothing else will save you. This guy has come to the end of his rope. If he had a rope, he'd hang himself. He's come to the pity of his life. He goes, woe is me. I am so undone. I have got so many problems. I've got so much bills. I've got so much. But God's servants, that guy's got cancer too, but he's still happy. That guy just had a wife die. He's still happy. He's got joy. He's got the same nasty boss that I got, and he's pleased. He does his work. What has he got that I ain't got? Why do we both have troubles, and he's got even more troubles than I, and he's got peace? And he something that I ain't got. May I go ask them? I've hit rock bottom. I will arise and go to my Father. I will say unto him, Father, capital F, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. Now these words are just said to him. He said, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to get up and I'm going to say these words to the God. And he rose and came to his father. But while he was yet great off, his father saw him and had compassion on him and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. When in your heart, you want to repent. When your heart wants to respect God, when you say, I hear, I'm listening to that preacher, but I don't know what to do. When you hear the messages week after week, Lord, I don't know what to do. Maybe I ought to repent. Maybe I ought to listen to that guy. Maybe I ought to do what that Bible has said to do. Realize, before you open your mouth, your heart is open to God and the Father comes to you.
He wants to apologize to you.
Not necessarily apologize, because I don't agree, but my friend, I care about a person and you probably are very thirsty.
Realize, God has not only shed his blood upon Calvary's cross, not only he has given the gospel that you may be saved, but when your heart finally gets right, God makes the first move to you. I'm going to get up out of this mire, I'm going to repent of my sins, I'm going to get right with the Father, and I'm going to, and God says, I'm getting up off the throne, and I'm going to run and meet that man, meet that heart. So while you're reaching out to God, God's reaching out to you. He makes the distance closer than it was when you were as a sinner and dying in your sin. As you come to God and say, I'm going to repent, I'm going to get right, God is getting closer to you. And you're getting closer and closer. Then it says God is running to you. And the Son said unto him, Father, now here is repentance. I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight. I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Repentance is not just saying a prayer. There are many prayers to be saved, and yet one prayer will save. There are many programs to get to heaven, yet there's one way. And when in your heart you decide to come to the Father, as the Bible says, God comes to you. And your words when you meet God is not how good I am. Your words are not, look God, aren't you so happy I've come. When you come to the Holy Father, by the Bible way, the truth and the life. You come to the Father by being a sinner. You don't change the words. You don't say, God, I've shacked up. You don't try to belittle your sins. Oh, it's just a little lie, God. I'm a sinner. And I am no longer worthy. The next thing that happens with your confession from your heart is you become humble. You never come to God in pride. You never come to God by a pope. You never come to God by magazines. You never come to God by works. You never come to God but by a heart that has been broken, by a mouth that has the true salvation of the Bible. Now, I could give you 200 million other ways to get saved, but I'm not going to waste my time with junk. I'm going to come with the one way, the one truth, and the one life. And that is met in the Lord Jesus Christ. This guy has been broken. He has been put down in the very worst of the worst. And he has come to the knowledge of who he is and what he is. And he didn't go to a psychiatrist. He didn't go to drugs. He didn't go to alcohol. He didn't go to his family. He went to God the Father and said, I have sinned and I am not worthy to be called yours. He says, I'm not worthy to be called your son. And yet, believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, coming to God, God's way, being saved by the Bible, by the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, God the Father records in the Bible that He adopts you and you become a son of God. See, I'm not worthy to be a son of God in the present sinful state. I am not worthy to be a son of God without Jesus Christ. I am not worthy to be a son of God as a Catholic. I am not worthy to be a son of God as a Baptist. I am not worthy of a son of God because I'm an elk. I am not worthy to be a son of God because I'm a human. I am in flesh. I am lusty. And I am sinful. And I am no longer able to be your son, God. I need your help. If thou shalt confess thy sins, He is able and just to forgive us our sins. And by the gospel, you can be adopted by God to be a son of God by the Lord Jesus Christ. Imagine being able to say, I am a son of God. As a born-again, Bible-believing Christian, I have that title. And if you are a Bible-believing, born-again Christian, you have the title, Son of God. I'm a child of the King. I'm a child of the Creator. I am a child of the Almighty. How? By Jesus Christ and the finished work upon Calvary and that empty tomb. But the Father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him. The Bible says, for those that are saved, white linen will be given. Linen is the righteousness of the saints. I know what I'm going to be wearing in heaven. And I know who gave it to me, the Father. Even after I've died, even after I've gone off into heaven, God is still providing my needs. Put a ring on his hand. That's authority. That's a family authority, that ring in the Scriptures. That sign still says, hey, that child belongs to me. I have the mark that marks me as a Christian. It is the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ that saved this sinful mess, wretch, lust, flesh, and everything else that's dirty, body, and soul, and spirit. John chapter 3 says, at one time I was in condemnation, I was in hell, but Jesus pulled me out by the gospel, by the grace, by the mercy, by the finished work, by the finished open tomb. Bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For my son was dead. In your state today, without Jesus Christ, in the eyes of God, you are dead. In trespass and in sin. I've got Mary. You're dead. I go door to door. You're dead. I've got money. You're dead. I've got Jesus Christ. You're alive. heart. The Bible records you are dead. You are a zombie. And I'm looking at the zombie apocalypse right now. Because I know all of you are not saved by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. You're dead walking bodies. And according to John chapter 3, you are in condemnation. You are already in hell. Only the gospel gets you out. So I broke away from John chapter 3 today to give you a little more Bible. But what we've been studying John chapter 3, we find in Luke chapter 15. In the eyes of God, your religion is dead. In the eyes of God, your works are dead. In the eyes of God, your belief is dead unless it is His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And is alive again. You want to live? You want to have life? That life is in Jesus Christ. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. Life is in Jesus Christ. Without Jesus Christ, you are dead. Now, next part of this verse, and we'll be closing. You've heard Christians use this, and it comes out of the Bible. He was lost. A man without Jesus Christ is lost. Religion makes you lost. Denial makes you lost. Rebellion makes you lost. Without Jesus Christ, you are lost. And you're dead. You're dead lost. And is found. When this young man came to the Father and repented of his sins and got his heart right and humbled and told God that I am a sinner, I am no worthy, I am not able to ever be like you or be with you, God. I am sorry for my sins. God says you were dead, but you're alive. He said you were lost, but now you are found. To be found by God is to come to God repenting. Humbleness by the blood and the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And thou shalt have eternal life. And they began to be merry. You want to make God happy? You want to make God pleased? You want to have a merry time with God? That's M-E-R-R-Y. I want to please God today. I can tell you exactly how, Luke 15. To come to God humbly. Come to God as a sinner. Come to God by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Come to God by the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will make God happy. If you come to God today, now, don't wait. You don't know when your time is up. Not only do you please God, but let me read another thing in Luke 15. Luke 15, if you were come to God and make Him happy by getting saved, becoming alive, I say in Luke 15, I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth, more than 99 just persons which need no repentance. Not only do you please God by being saved, but the angels in heaven pick up and upon you, and the angels and God break out in celebration and merriness because a sinner has come home. And you wonder where that expression comes from. A sinner has come home. Out of Luke chapter 15. He left his father's home. Garden of Eden. He's no longer in the presence of God. Genesis chapter 3. And he comes back to God. Calvary. About 33 A.D. And remains in the presence of God forever. That story of that young man could be you today. The way to please God in your lost, dead state is to become alive, to become found through the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. What must I do to be